Welcome to BNews Weekly. I'm Phil Gallagher along with BNews producer Sydney Bowles, BNews reporters Robert Parris and Tad Stefanak, Chris Flaherty with the weather, and Gretchen Carey with the community calendar. Thank you for joining us. The Burlington Police Department is warning residents to lock their vehicles after a series of car break-ins in local neighborhoods. According to Detective Ashley Portnoy, who is working on the case, the incidents were in the Windmere area, and based on video footage from homes, there are believed to be two people involved driving a light-colored, possibly silver sedan. One resident impacted was Select Board member Sarah Colley. She posted on Facebook, and I quote, "Friendly reminder to lock your cars. I know this is common sense by now, but we all have our lapses in that. It's me. Hi." Colley said nothing was taken from her vehicle, but everything in her center console was dumped on the passenger seat. The police are encouraging people to report any suspicious activity. The BPD non-emergency line is 781-272-1212. The Burlington School Committee this week began discussion of a long-term facilities master plan, a living document that will help prioritize major upgrades and new buildings for years to come. Director of Operations Bob Kuna presented the draft.
We have looked at the 10-year capital plan in conjunction with the town in multiple ways since I've been here and even prior to that. One, it's been looked at as a wish list, and then second, it's been looked at as also what actually happens, so it gets updated year to year. Now, this may also be considered a wish list in some eyes as well, too, but a lot of this that's in place is a lot of wear and tear. So we know that roofs are gonna go, we know that bathrooms need to be refinished, we know that HVAC systems need to be rehabbed. Of course, there's gonna be things that come up that we don't know about yet, 5 years, 6 years down the road, and we'll have to fill those in. But for us to forget, let's say roof, for example, since we just did the roof here at the high school, let's say 8 years ago, we kind of put that on the back of our mind, and then all of a sudden 10 years, 12 years, 13 years goes by, and now we have to remember to put that.
The master plan comes after the school committee met with pushback for a proposed $6.7 million field renovation project at Mays Town Meeting. At that time, the Ways and Means Committee felt the project hadn't been appropriately planned for in the town's debt schedule. In the end, a reduced $4.7 million version of the plan was approved. This draft, a plan, did not include dollar amounts since it can be difficult to project 5, 10, or 15 years into the future, but the school committee asked the administration to consider ways to prioritize or estimate costs for the projects. High school students in Burlington will soon have expanded opportunities for work experience in the tech industry. The district is working to expand its flipped internship program into a summer experience connecting students with professionals in local firms. Computer science teacher Shireen Terrill is developing the project, explaining the flipped internship model.
The idea is that we want kids to have work-related experiences, but in technology companies, it's really hard to place large numbers of students. I know we have some kids working here in IT, but to place like 40 or 50 kids is really challenging. So working with MITRE, we came up with a model where we would have kids working here in the school doing capstone projects under the supervision of teachers. We also hire college students to help them. And then the way the industry involved, and wonderful mentors like Jeremy, is that we bring industry to Burlington High School. So each student has a mentor. Students meet either individually or in groups of two or three with their mentors, and they meet weekly, and they have a list of topics that they can stick with if they want to, and it's just been fantastic. It's been phenomenal, I think, the impact on the kids. They all get so much out of it. It's not just learning about technology, but talking to mentors. They learn about life choices and how to manage their time and, you know, what are the different things that their mentors went through. So it's awesome. It's a great opportunity for them to learn from other people, practice networking skills, and now they have somebody on the outside world at all these different companies that they can access when they're job hunting.
Terrell's computer science classes will be reassigned to other teachers so she can focus on the program in depth. The school committee took a moment on Tuesday to remember Fox Hill Elementary School special education teacher Audrey Boeri, who passed away this month after a long battle with ALS. Let's turn to school committee chair Christine Monaco.
I would just like to do as Melissa did at the beginning of the last meeting, ask for a moment of silence for Audrey Boeri. She was a special ed teacher at Fox Hill School, and I know from personally being involved that she was absolutely wonderful. She worked with one of my grandchildren who has special needs, and no one has ever been better at what Audrey did, and she will be missed by all the people that she worked with, all the children that she worked with, and all the parents who really, really appreciated her. So on that note, deepest sympathy to her family and friends, and please let's have a moment of silence.
The Burlington Planning Board and its planning staff are expressing skepticism over a proposed warrant article that would allow recreational marijuana shops in town. Burlington resident Will Seagard, who runs a cannabis cultivation facility in Fitchburg, has proposed two warrant articles for the September town meeting. One, a general bylaw article, would change the language in the town's bylaws to allow the shops, and a second zoning article would create an overlay district in the Mall Road, Middlesex Turnpike area where the stores could be permitted. Planning Director Liz Bonventre said she had concerns about the language in Seagard's articles.
I've done a little bit of research on other communities and what they do and kind of comparing their bylaws to what this is. And I've also had discussions with people who've worked in Tangsboro, and Tangsboro was one of the first communities to adopt this. So, you know, this doesn't kind of match those. I've looked at, you know, Newton and Belmont, and there are some, it doesn't meet the kind of standards that those municipalities have, and I don't think it goes far enough to protect the town from, you know, lawsuits or just making sure that everything is held up to a high standard. You know, I think that, you know, if the town were to kind of coalesce around this idea and kind of, you know, work to collaboratively with different boards and commissions and everybody to come up with something, if this is a concept that they believe that people of the town would like to see happen, I think that that's something that, you know, we would, as staff, we would pursue. Mm-hmm. But at this time, I'm uncomfortable. I'm afraid that it's my professional opinion that this doesn't go far enough.
You may remember on this program not too long ago, we told you about Julie Lewis, the Burlington Food Pantry manager, who was recently awarded a Commonwealth Heroin Award for her work with the Burlington Community Collaborative. That's a group of nonprofits and government agencies that meet to build connections across town. BNews producer Sydney Bowles paid them a visit at a quarterly meeting earlier this month. It took place in the offices of the Mama Bear Effect, and after everyone shared what the agencies were up to, the collaboration really began. As people shared what they were seeing, the collaborative learned that the migrant families housed in a Burlington hotel were having a hard time over the summer. Some dozen of young children are stuck in hotel rooms with no transportation during the summer and no access to the outdoors, activities, or open spaces. By the end of the meeting, groups had come together to help UCC pastor Andrew Harris, had volunteers from his church who could drive vans. Youth and Family Services could provide the vehicle, and the police department could donate car seats. The group could take kids to concerts on the common or play at the library. The group plans to continue meeting quarterly to help address challenges, big and small, around Burlington. If you're looking for some kid-friendly entertainment this weekend, the Burlington Educational Summer Theater has just the thing. The curtain rises on their production of Matilda Jr. this weekend. Let's take a look.
The Burlington Educational Summer Theater is back in the Fogelberg Auditorium for another production. This time, it's Matilda Jr., based on the book by Roald Dahl.
We have about 86 kids. The stage is full, so we've had to think outside the box. We built a thrust that goes over the orchestra pit so we can have students out there. We're putting students out in the audience and on the sides. So, in addition to the layers of set, different levels, there's upstairs and platforms. So we want to make sure everybody can be seen by their parents. So that's been a big challenge, how to get 88 students seen by their parents and by the audience.
With so many actresses and actors, it's hard to keep everyone in line. Director Kim Cook took on the challenge.
We've been watching many of these kids grow up from fourth grade up to getting ready to enter the high school now. So it's been really exciting to see both how much those kids have grown and to see new kids come along and to know where the program's headed. So that's been great. And we've been with Burlington High Theater Department for many, many years, and it's nice to be able to be here kind of pushing the next generation along and giving back to these kids what we got so much out of.
Since this is a musical, one of the choreographers is Kim's daughter, Jamie.
We've got some big, big numbers in this show. We have a song called Revolting Children, which is one of the most famous songs from Matilda. We have a big sequence with Bruce where he eats the cake, and all of those took us a full 2 weeks to get up on their feet, but they look amazing. The biggest challenge is the amount of kids in the program this year. It's amazing to see the program grow, but we do have about 85 kids that we're trying to fit up there on the stage. But as choreographer, I get to really put them into this big picture and make it a really exciting number with all our kids in it.
I had a chance to speak with some other performers in the production.
It's very exciting. When I saw that I got the role, I was so excited. This is my first lead role other than JoJo last year.
I'm not usually a mean person in real life, so it was definitely interesting. And I'm still getting the hang of not always smiling or just trying not to be nice when I'm saying my lines. But it's really fun because it's my first lead role and it's really enjoyable.
I feel Miss Honey is a very shy and insecure person at the beginning of the musical, but I love seeing her journey as she becomes bolder and stronger thanks to Matilda.
The show kicks off on July 26th at 7 p.m. and on July 27th for a matinee performance at 2 p.m. For tickets, go to burlingtontheater.com or call 781-A-FUN-TICK.
People are going to be blown away by the amount of energy, the amount of the volume of the voices and the number of students, and it's just going to be, I think people are going to really be blown away.
Oh, I think Matilda's message is what we really want everyone to take home is, you can't let being little stop you, whether it's, your age or your size or, your confidence, that you have to get up there and, fight for what you want and really go after it. And these kids have 100% done that today, so.
From the Fogelberg Performing Arts Center, I'm Robert Paris for B News Weekly.
There's always something fun going on at the Burlington Mall, including Sunset Salsa with special guests. Tad Stefanak has more.
This summer, the Burlington Mall is hosting a series of Sunset Salsa parties. Bringing the moves are the dancers from Meta Movements.
So we are collaborating with the Burlington Mall because the Burlington Mall has this beautiful space that's new and they're looking to fill it with lots of fun activities for everybody. And they asked us to come in and we brought the party with us.
This fun and free event begins with salsa lessons for everyone from the novice to the more advanced dancers. And when the salsa classes are finished, the event becomes a free-for-all salsa dance party. Complete with performances by some of the dancers.
It's free and open to everyone, so you can come through and dance, have some fun, get to meet new people. Then sign up if you'd like to get information about other events. We work in different parts of the city all summer long, offering free outdoor Latin dance events for everyone.
From the Burlington Mall, I'm B News reporter Tad Stefanak.
Lahey Hospital and Medical Center announced recently they've been recognized as a top hospital in Massachusetts. The recognition comes from U.S. World End News Report and identified 13 areas where Leahy was particularly high performing. Leahy was named as the number 5 best hospital in the Boston region and number 6 best hospital in Massachusetts. You may have noticed some new art in the Burlington Sculpture Park lately. Over the next few weeks, we're introducing you to those new pieces, starting with a piece that shows you just one of the ways you can engage with the artwork.
Well, there's some new artwork at the Sculpture Park. We have 5 new sculptures that were all installed this July.
Sculpture Park Committee Chair Barbara LaRue has been working to bring new artwork to Burlington's town center with votes and input from Burlington students.
This is the first one. It's called Sunday Paper. It's by an artist called Madeline Lord. Interestingly, this is only the second sculpture throughout this entire experiment that we've done since 2020 that is done by a woman. It turns out there are not very many women who do large-scale sculptures. The other female artist is Barbara Fletcher, who did Lumen, the dragonfly. What I like about it is it's kind of what we want people to do here. Sit down and enjoy the area. This is a sculpture of a man sitting on a bench reading a newspaper. And I can't tell you how many times I've driven by here and seen people sitting on the benches, not necessarily with a newspaper anymore, but just enjoying the day, enjoying the sculptures and sitting. And in this case, this guy's reading. But I think it's sort of a picture of small town America, sitting on a bench reading a newspaper. And that's what I like about it.
August 3rd is Celebrate Burlington, a big day for being proud of our hometown. Peter Kabola of the Burlington Historical Society has some suggestions for ways to enjoy the day.
Hey, next Saturday, August 3rd, we're going to be having a big party in the Commons. It's the annual Burlington celebration. It's a time to reflect on our past, celebrate the present, and meet and greet with our neighbors to plan for the future. One of the activities reflecting on our past will be the trolley tour. It will be leaving at 11 o'clock from the Common, and the tickets are free. It's going to be a ride around town to look at and learn the history of some of our homes, landmarks, just discussion on the trolley. If you do come on Saturday, the museum will be open, so swing by. I'll be here along with a couple of other commissioners, and we'll be happy to give you a tour of Burlington's past.
Now let's turn to Chris Flaherty, filling in for Peter Brown with the weather, and stay tuned for your community calendar with Gretchen Carey.
Hey everyone, this is Chris Flaherty with your BNews Weather Report, filling in for Peter Brown, who is out this week. We're just about 2/3 of the way through summer, but don't stress, there's still plenty of time to make the most of the season, especially now since we're getting a bit of a break from the humidity. Looking ahead to the 7-day forecast, we'll see those temperatures slowly start to tick up. Starting on Friday, it'll be mostly sunny out with a high of 84 and a low of 60, and that will pretty much be the same for Saturday, with the average low temperature creeping up to 63 degrees. Sunday, we shouldn't see many clouds, and the temperature will go up to a high of 86 and a low of 65. Monday will be partly cloudy with a high of 88 and a low of 69, and it looks like we're going to hold on to that high of 88 for the rest of the week. The clouds will stick around on Tuesday with a low of 68 degrees. Wednesday, there's a good chance we'll see some rainfall from those clouds, but the average low temperature will increase to 71 degrees. Finally, we enter August on Thursday with a chance of thunderstorms in the afternoon and evening with an average low of 70 degrees. So folks, as it gradually starts to get a little warmer, make sure you keep the water bottles handy as well as those umbrellas just in case. Fortunately though, it looks like the rain will be moving on in time for Celebrate Burlington next weekend. But until next time, this has been Chris Flaherty filling in for Peter Brown with your BNews Weather Report. Stay hydrated and have a great week.
Hi, I'm Amy Poehler and you're watching BCAT. Go Red Devils.
Hey everyone. I'm Gretchen Carey, and this is your community calendar.
On August 2nd, from 10:30 a.m. to 12:30 p.m., the Burlington Public Library will be having Friday Flicks. The movie they are showing is Princess Bride. No registration is required for the event. On August 3rd, starting at 11 a.m., the Burlington Parks and Recreation Department will be having the Celebrate Burlington event on the Town Common. For more details on the event, go to their website. On August 8th, the Parks and Recreation Department will be having a day trip to beautiful Martha's Vineyard. To register, go to the department's website. For more community calendar events, go to bcattv.org, burlingtonpubliclibrary.org, and burlingtonrecreation.org. I'm Gretchen Carey, and that was your community calendar.
And as we do every week, we're finishing up with a photo sent in by a member of the community. Ted Vazikas sent in this incredible shot of a hawk posing for the camera in his front yard. Thank you, Ted. If you have a photo you'd like to see featured here, email it to us at bcat@bcattv.org with the subject line photo of the week. That's our program for this week. We'll leave you with a project from a friend of the show, Rabbi Susan Abraham of Shalom Emeth. In addition to caring for her congregation at Temple Shalom Emeth, Rabbi Abramson loves to help animals find their forever homes. I'm Phil Gallagher. Thank you for watching. We'll see you again next week.
If you change your mind, take a chance on the first in line, take a chance on me, I'm still free. Take a chance on me. If you need me, let me know. Gonna be around. If you got no place to go, when you're feeling down. If you're all alone, when the breathing hurts, I know, honey, I'm still free. Take a chance on me.
Stephanie, I am the volunteer community engagement coordinator here at Upper Valley Humane Society, and I am here to introduce you to Chance, who is one of our wonderful, wonderful dogs. I can't wait for you to meet her and learn more about her. She's got kind of a sad story. She was found in an abandoned apartment. So when she first came in, she was in pretty rough shape, but she has come so far. She is just really social with people. She loves meeting new people. She is friendly with them on the first meeting. She's not so great with other dogs, so she needs to go to a home where she is your only dog and she can get all of your love and attention. And I think in that kind of environment, she would just flourish. If you'd like to meet Chance and schedule a meet and greet with her, you can email us at info@uvhs.org or call us at 603-448-6888. We'd love to have you come on by and meet her and maybe meet your new best friend.
Honey, I'm still free. Take a chance on me. If you need me, let me know. Gonna be around. If you got no place to go.